Good afternoon, everyone, or good morning to some of you in the Western time zones. This is Erica Jensen with the Great Lakes Commission, and I'd like to welcome you to the Invasive Mussel Collaborative Webinar, Case Studies and Responses to and Management of Invasive Mussel Infestations. And on behalf of the Mussel Collaborative, thank you for participating in our webinar today. For those of you unfamiliar with the Invasive Mussel Collaborative, we were convened in 2015 to identify opportunities to advance scientifically sound technology for management and control of invasive dry-seeded mussels to produce measurable ecological and economic benefits. And if you would like to know more about the Invasive Mussel Collaborative, we encourage you to visit our website at www.invasivemusselcollaborative.net. Today's webinar is part of an ongoing series hosted by the Collaborative. And the purpose of our webinars is to facilitate learning and information sharing on topics of common interest within the invasive mussel community. The webinar will be recorded and archived along with past and future webinars on our website. Today's webinar is focused on case studies highlighting the response and management associated with invasive mussel infestations from across the country and primarily the western part of the Great Lakes Basin and beyond. And we're pleased to have representatives from the Minnesota Department of Natural Resources, the Nebraska Invasive Species Program, based out of the University of Nebraska, and the Montana Fish, Wildlife, and Parks Department joining us today to share their experiences. In terms of technology and the webinar itself, we always strive to minimize technological issues during our webinars, and so we apologize if you do have issues. But we do have a couple of logistical items that may help that we'll all go over right now. Audio for the webinar is automatically streamed through your computer speakers once you join the Skype event. And you also have the option to dial into the webinar using a telephone. To change your audio to a telephone line, you can select Switch Audio to My Phone from the banner at the top of the screen and click Connect from the pop-up screen. A second pop-up will list the number to call into, as well as a conference ID number to connect to the webinar. In order to minimize the potential for interruptions and background noise, we will automatically mute all attendees, and attendees' lines will remain muted throughout the webinar. That being said, we do encourage and will accept written questions from anybody attending the webinar throughout the webinar. If you have a question, you may type it into the chat box, which is signified by the chat bubble icon in the lower left-hand corner of your screen. Questions, as I said, may be submitted at any time during the webinar. We will do our best to take questions for a particular presenter after their presentation, but depending on time, we may hold the majority of questions following all of the presentations because we want to make sure to give our speakers plenty of time to give their presentations. As I said, we'll do our best to take all questions or comments during the webinar. If you have to leave the webinar before we've gotten to your question, we encourage you to review the webinar recording that will be posted on our website to hear the question and answer at a later time. If you do end up experiencing technical difficulties, you may send a message through the chat box to one of the organizers. My colleagues, Ceci Weibert or Eric Ellis, can help address technological issues. And finally, to view today's presentations in a full screen format, you will need to change your screen layout to content view. To change the layout, select the layout icon in the upper right corner of your screen, indicated by the red circle on the slide that we're showing right now. Choose presentation view or content view. So now that we've gone through those logistical items, I will introduce our first presenter for today. Our first presenter is Keegan Lund. He is an aquatic biologist with the Minnesota Department of Natural Resources and serves as the invasive species specialist for the Twin Cities metro area counties along south and south along the Mississippi River to Iowa. His work focuses on prevention, monitoring, and management of aquatic invasive plants and invertebrates. So Keegan, we should be all set to hand off presenter status to you, and you're welcome to get started.
Thank you.
Keegan, we can see your slides. Are you unmuted? You can press star 6 to unmute yourself. It looks like we may be having some technical difficulties getting Keegan connected. So Allison, are you there? Do you mind if we skip ahead and go to your presentation first?
Yes, I'm here if you can hear me.
We can hear you. Let me just introduce you really quickly. Instead, we'll start this morning with Allison Zack. Allison received her bachelor's degree from the University of Nebraska in Natural Resources and her master's degree from Minnesota State University in Wildlife Management. She has served as the coordinator of the Nebraska Invasive Species Program for the past 5 years, and she serves as the Aquatic Invasive Species Coordinator on the state and regional AIS panels. Previously, she worked at the Nebraska Department of Roads and Department of Environmental Quality, obtaining environmental clearances for permits and projects. So, Allison, thank you for being flexible, and we should be okay to go on to your presentation.
Okay.
You should have control now.
Okay. I'm going to talk today about some invasive species infestations in Nebraska and kind of how we handled them. This is a current map showing the orange triangles are areas, water bodies that have tested positive for zebra mussels. We have 4 positive water bodies, which means that we've had more than one sampling event which was positive for either zebra mussel larvae or adults. Currently, Lewis and Clark Lake, which is by Yankton, South Dakota, is positive for zebra mussels and it is quite infested. We have a new infestation at Lake Yankton that we just found this year. The entire length of the Missouri River in the Nebraska, on the Nebraska border, is considered infested. And then also Opfit Air Force Base Lake in Bellevue, Nebraska, is infested. We have 2 suspect water bodies, which means we've had a single water sample which came back positive from zebra mussels, but we haven't had a subsequent positive. And that would be Lake Zerinsky in Omaha, Nebraska, and then Carter Lake, which is right by the Omaha Airport. So I'll first talk about Offutt Air Force Base, which is in Bellevue, Nebraska, which is near Omaha. And this is a 113-acre lake, which is open to military, family, and personnel. We found zebra mussel adults there in 2006. And the base then closed the outlet tubes that were taking water from the lake to the Missouri River. They also banned motorized boats at that time. And they treated the lake in 2008 and 2009 with copper sulfate to kill the zebra mussels. Fishermen then reported to the base in 2014 that they were finding zebra mussel shells on the shore. And sure enough, when we went out there, we found that the lake was heavily infested. We've been doing research annually at the lake since that time to monitor the zebra mussel population growth and also the fishery itself. We have introduced 60,000 red-eared sunfish to the lake, which are known to prey upon zebra mussels. This is in 2014, right after we got that call to go out and verify it, and there's lots of concrete and riprap at this lake, and so it was easy enough to just walk right out and pick up a piece of concrete, and every one of them we would find about one adult on. We went back in July and you'll see that the rocks look very different. They were completely covered in juveniles. Subsequently, when we went out in September, we found that many of those juveniles had not survived and had been outcompeted. And so we would find groupings like this of adults on rocks or trees. And so we looked at the veliger, the larva densities in relation to water temperature. And so we went out in May of 2015 when the water temperature was 62 degrees, and we were finding a density of 56 zebra mussels. And this again was with water toes. We found that we have the highest densities in June when the water temps were 63 or 72 degrees. And then we also found that in July when the water temp was 84, we had a high 96 density as well. One other interesting thing we did was we took a drone out there to do some water sampling, because you'll see on the bottom our normal toes are a net and a rope, which you need to decontaminate between water bodies, which is a process. Well, we had a drone lab on campus and they had been sampling wetlands for salinity using this drone. So we took it out and it takes water through that tube, through the same micron filter we use when we do water sampling, and then spit the water right back out. And we were able to actually find villagers with that drone. So it was a positive proof of concept. However, we found a very low density of zebra mussel larvae with that method. And so before we can make that, you know, a viable sampling in the future, we would need to do some more development. But the neat thing about it is the tubing and the filter can be taken off that drone, and then it can go to another water body and put on a clean hose and filter and use it the same day. So it was a tool we might look at in the future. The base currently is looking at a way to cover the riprap, which is right under the water surface, to reduce available habitat for the zebra mussels. And so that's something that they're just going to look at this coming year to hopefully reduce some of that riprap and concrete availability that the zebra mussels are using as habitat. Lake Zarensky is in Omaha, Nebraska, and a Boy Scout found a beer can in 2019 on the shore, which is pictured above, and reported it to my program's website. The Corps then, in response to that, decided to draw down the lake. There's an outlet structure you can see in the arrow on the right, and they were able to open that and to pump out enough water to draw the lake down 17 feet. And they did that in the winter of 2010. They then let it freeze and stay that way and refilled it then in 2012 and reopened it in 2011 and reopened in 2012. And so the idea there was to draw it down to freeze out zebra mussels and then to refill it. I then got a public report last year, in 2016 in May, from a fisherman that said he had a zebra mussel on his fishing line. I said, did you keep it? And he said, no, I put it back in the lake. And I said, thank you. So I went out the next day and took a lot of water samples using our plankton net toes. And we sent those to the lab. But before I did that, I had a technician look under our microscope, and she did verify a zebra mussel larva. We sent it to the Montana lab, which does all of our analysis. And they came back to us in June 22nd and said, yes, we found many villagers, and we found three different life stages of them. The Corps and the Game and Parks immediately went out after finding that out and tried to find adults on rocks or any on the perimeter of the lake. They did not find any. eDNA from that water sample that was sent to Montana came back positive right before the July 4th weekend. That was just another verification that it was in fact zebra mussels from that same water sample. And at that time we considered Zarensky a suspect water body because we've only had one water sampling event that came back positive for zebra mussels. This shows the lake, and you'll see on the right there's three red X's. That's where I went and I sampled. The two on the left are where the fisherman was based, and that's a little boat ramp. And so those were areas I sampled, and then on the right is a fishing pier that I also sampled. And we use a plankton tow, you throw it out, you draw it back in, it's filtering gallons of water, and whatever is trapped inside is what we're looking at under a microscope, and then using eDNA secondarily. And this is what the microscopy looks like. They look under the microscope to try to find a cross-polarized microscope, and that's where Montana verified that they did find different sizes of zebra mussels. And this shows the three different life stages that they did observe, and they did observe them in the water sample. And this specific is what those close up on the boat ramps use. A lot of times when we find zebra mussels, it's at boat ramps, so it wasn't a surprise that that is the location we found them again. And this right here shows you the different locations where people actually physically went out and sampled to look for adult zebra mussels right after we got that positive sample back, and they were not able to find any. So what we did right on the 4th of July weekend, we decided not the city and a bunch of agencies met as soon as we got that eDNA and the panel information back. And so we posted signage and immediately told the public that we were not going to draw it down. This lake is in a residential area surrounded by lots of houses. And there were mixed opinions on the drawdown the last time. And so they just were not going to go forward with it at this time. It is a suspect because we were not able to find any adults at this time. It will be positive if we do. And we have done voter surveys at this lake to give information to the public on what that means and how to clean, drain, dry to prevent the spread of zebra mussels. Last year, we had 8 technicians in Nebraska. I employed 2 in the Game and Parks, employed 6, and they went throughout the state and interviewed boaters and also did boat inspections. And we use tablets to record that. We have a survey that gathers information on travel patterns of boaters, so we know where to focus our outreach and prevention. Also, it has information on clean, drain, dry, and bait usage. And it's real-time results so that we can modify where we have technicians if needed. We found that since 2012, when we really started doing outreach, people have been employing those clean, drain, dry behaviors much more. You'll see that people in 2012, only 77% were visually inspecting their boats, but in 2014, 95% were. And in 2012, only 39% of people were removing vegetation from their boats, 96% were in 2014. So we found that our outreach has really affected and helped protect our water bodies. The Game and Parks has a motorboat registration fee for residents and a non-resident motorboat sticker, which is an annual sticker, and that funds an aquatic invasive species prevention program at the state. And that went into effect in 2016, and they use that to do outreach, do boat inspections, and manage AIS. Lewis and Clark Lake is a 31,400 surface acre water body. It has 90 miles of shoreline and the depth of 45 feet. So this is a heavily infested lake, and we've had a challenge because there's so many access points, and it's shared by Nebraska and South Dakota. In 2014, South Dakota found an adult zebra mussel on a boat dock. At that time, we considered the water body suspect. We had been doing water sampling annually up until then and since, and we had never found a veliger. So to find this adult first was a rare occasion, because normally we find veligers, there's just so many in the water body. In August of 2015, then we found zebra mussels at a South Dakota boat repair shop. The AIS coordinator just happened to be at a boat shop, said, "I'm going to inspect these boats, go for it," and he found zebra mussels on two of the boats. They immediately then had snorkelers go out into the marina, and on the underside of every dock, they were finding adult zebra mussels and of different size. So we knew that we had an infestation that had been there for at least a few years. This is what the current underside of floating docks look like at Lewis and Clark Lake. You can see on this bottom right picture, the juveniles on top of the adults. This is a very established infestation, and a lot of people were not taking their motors completely out of the water this past season, and it clogged their motors. And so people are really seeing now the impacts of this. So what South Dakota has done to mitigate this is they created a transportation zone, which allows people that are only using boats on Lewis and Clark Lake to sign up for registry, and then they do not require decontamination if they're staying on that lake. They employed two full-time techs at Lewis and Clark Lake, and each of them had a mobile decontamination unit. They did a study with divers to look at the zebra mussel population density at this time so they can monitor it over time. Also, they're certifying boat shops and marinas to do contaminations on watercrafts, because they only have two technicians, but there's so many boat shops and marinas there. That's a way to decontaminate as many watercrafts as possible. Nebraska sent a paper survey to slip holders at Lewis and Clark Lake to learn about their behaviors, and they also had a full-time technician at the lake. Municipal water and irrigators, I put them in touch with other states so that they knew what to do to maintain their systems from getting clogged. The Missouri River, I mentioned, we found zebra mussels through the entire length of it in 2016. We had a technician go to each one of the boat launches on the Missouri, and they were finding adults at each one. So the whole length of it's considered infested. And so we've been telling the public and putting signs up to clean, drain, dry. Do not relaunch within 5 days, 2 weeks is better, but just make sure everything is dry, clean, and inspected. And these are the specific boat ramps that we actually found the zebra mussels on in yellow there. We have three power facilities that draw water specifically from the Missouri River in Nebraska. We have Fort Calhoun up north Omaha, and then we have Nebraska City. And these are all managed by the Omaha Public Power District. And what they have found is that back in March of 16, Fort Calhoun, that one up north, they found two zebra mussels in their facility. But jump forward to September of this year, they found 10,000. North Omaha, they've only had one sample event, which was in 2017, and so far they've only had 20, so that one's definitely not as bad as Fort Calhoun. Nebraska City, you'll see in May of 17, they had 6 zebra mussels, and that jumped to 6.2 million in October. So it's amazing how quickly this infestation has grown. And this shows you the 6 million in their power facility, what that looks like. So they immediately took a work request out to get a power washer to go into their facility and power wash all those mussels off their intake units and within their power facility. They then are putting out a treatment options to better understand what they're gonna do, because they need to find permanent solutions to keep these facilities open. And so while they're doing that, they're gonna manually clean the insides of these facilities to keep them running. And so what they're looking at is probably a combination of things. You know, there's different chemicals you can use, there's UV light systems you can use, and their coatings. And so they're getting different ideas right now, and then they will choose their path forward, and it'll be to be seen what they decide. Please visit my website, anyinvasives.com. This is where we send everybody in Nebraska for AIS information, and we update it with new sightings and findings. Also, you can report invasive species sightings, and that's how we have been alerted by both zebra mussel findings at Lake Zerinsky. And that's my email address, and again, my website.
Thank you, Allison. At this point, I am not seeing any questions come in, but we will monitor that chat box. As a reminder to our attendees, you can type in a question at any time. So we'll go ahead and move to our next presentation from Keegan. I believe he has reconnected and we have him back on the line. But Allison, if you can stay with us, we may have questions come in later on during the webinar that we'll revisit at the end.
Okay.
Thank you. So Keegan, if you're on the phone, I've already done your introduction, so I won't
do
it
good.
Again.
Yeah. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can hear you fine.
Great. Sorry about that. I was the networking gods took over, I guess.
Happened. So you're all
set now. Sounds good. So I'm gonna go through some of the experience that we've had in Minnesota over the last 4 years specifically in what we've termed pilot projects, but they're really eradication efforts on inland lakes in Minnesota. Minnesota obviously is different from Nebraska in that, we have an abundance of natural inland lakes, few reservoirs, so to speak, and we've had zebra mussels in the state since 1989. So briefly talk about the infestation rate in Minnesota and what we've seen, talk a little bit about a few specific control methods that have been in the literature and tried throughout the country, and then dive into eradication efforts in Minnesota on four little case studies, three of which are in the metro area, Minneapolis-St. Paul area, and then one in northern Minnesota. And then talk about some of the lessons that we've learned through these projects. So as I mentioned before, zebra mussels were first discovered in the Duluth Harbor, which if you're looking at the map now, Lake Superior is obviously the large lake on the right-hand side. Duluth Harbor, discovered in 1989, moved through riverways, major riverways, and then were first discovered in a metro lake in 2010, and that was Lake Minnetonka. Minnesota, depending on how you count them, has anywhere from 9,000 to 12,000 lakes. Less than 2% of these lakes are listed as infested. The Minnesota Department of Natural Resources declares lakes as infested and places signage up and has specific rules regulating the water of those infested waters. And so far, less than 2% of those lakes are infested. One caveat would be Those 2% are many of the high use larger recreational water bodies in the state. There are still other high use recreational lakes that are not infested, but that is changing slowly or quickly depending on how you look at the time frame. 150 lakes, rivers, and wetlands are confirmed infested with zebra mussels, and then another 153 listed due to connectivity. So downstream waters, immediately downstream waters are generally listed as infested as well. And one thing that we have seen in the last probably 3 to 5 years is the rate of lakes being declared as infestation as infested has gone up quite a bit. I think this is most likely due to the fact that we do have more eyes on the water. There are throughout the state quite a few early detection monitoring programs underway that are implemented either by the DNR or by other local units of government, or sometimes by volunteer lake associations. So there are definitely a lot more eyes on the water than used to be. In addition, University of Minnesota has the Minnesota Aquatic Invasive Species Research Center, and they also have a detection program as well where they train volunteers. So, as you all likely know, control efforts are really difficult, and we've seen this this life stage diagram before, but the difficulty in controlling zebra mussels first, in my experience, is that number one, they're difficult to find, and you really have to be looking for them in an active early detection monitoring program to find them early enough to attempt any sort of control effort. They're broadcast spawners, you know, one female said to be able to release 500,000 eggs in a season. Once water temperature is around 55 degrees, they have this free floating larval state. So once released and fertilized, you know, they're mobile in the water. And then again, looking at the size, the photograph on the right is a picture of a settlement sampler plate. So it's, you know, a tool used in early detection monitoring, but also kind of tells you when it's too late, because once you have zebra mussels there, they're likely everywhere. But it just shows you the size that we're dealing with when trying to find this organism, you know, something potentially the size of a grain of sand up to, you know, your fingernail. Underwater in low clarity conditions, as you can imagine, can be difficult. So briefly, some of the physical control methods, and this is not a laundry list. There potentially are other strategies that have been tried throughout the United States, but in my experience, these are some of the main control methods that have been utilized to try to suppress or eradicate zebra mussel populations. The first, hand removal. Lake Mille Lacs is one of the largest recreational fisheries in Minnesota, and when zebra mussels were first discovered there, there was an attempt by DNR staff to do physical removal via scuba. It quickly became unsustainable because of reproduction rates. Lake George is an example that is in the literature. I believe last I had heard that the populations of zebra mussels in Lake George have been suppressed through, you know, hand removal. Also, though, that the water quality conditions in that lake may not be favorable to support large populations of zebra mussels. So there may be other limiting factors there, but I believe that is the one case that I'm aware of where hand removal of an early infestation has held. Other physical control methods using benthic barriers, obviously you wouldn't utilize this likely in an entire lake setting, but potentially for early infestations. Minnesota has not attempted this yet. The example there is Lake Tahoe has done some projects, you know, with Asian clams. I'm sure there's others throughout the United States as well. And then drawdowns, as was discussed earlier in Minnesota, we've also tried this once in Lake Zumbro, which is a reservoir maintained with a water control structure. Water was drawn down. Unfortunately, it wasn't drawn down sufficiently enough. All the zebra mussels weren't killed, and it did not work. The majority of our lakes in Minnesota, too, the idea of a drawdown just is not feasible, largely, I would say, with stakeholders. So that moves us to molluscicide control, or, you know, control of zebra mussels through pesticides. Open water applications, you know, the main products that we've considered in Minnesota are some sort of copper-based products, largely EarthTech QZ, because it does have a label registered for this use. We've tried potassium chloride or potash, Zequinox as well. And, you know, from our experience, important considerations are obviously maintaining product concentration in the water over a sufficient exposure time, you know, mortality of these organisms depending on water temperature, and the rates you're using. We're talking about generally exposures over a week period, give or take. And then, of course, considerations to non-target organisms, you know. Okay, I'm just going to push on from there, matter of time. So I mentioned the DNR pilot projects. It's kind of the format that we've used to filter potential eradication projects through. The considerations that we look at, first we have a kind of multidisciplinary review panel. So if there is a group that is looking at some sort of eradication project, there's generally partners involved. They come, present kind of the information that they have. There's a required list of monitoring conditions and pre-treatment surveys that need to take place as well. Review panel kind of goes through it and says, what is the likelihood that this may work? And then makes a decision as to whether or not the DNR will permit the activity. These projects often involve quite a few local players as well, be they lake associations, local units of government, and the projects that have taken place have been funded as, you know, partnerships as well, funding through the state, local units of government, lake associations directly. So it really does has taken a lot of hands in these projects to I think make them successful. And then another thing that we started early on with these projects is we realized we wanted to learn something. So the University of Minnesota, the Minnesota Aquatic Invasive Species Research Center, helped the DNR develop monitoring protocols to look at mortality associated with the treatment, but then also look at population monitoring after the treatment, looking at expansion, success, things like that. You know, so one of the things that probably can't be stressed enough is the significance of a lake-wide survey effort before a pilot project is initiated, and also as it's being initiated, asking the questions, is the zebra mussel population lake-wide or is it isolated? Is there evidence of reproduction? In Minnesota, that's largely been, that's we've tried to tease that out through Bellinger toes, similar to what was described earlier. Minnesota doesn't have a lot of experience using eDNA, partly just because of, I think, lack of availability in the past, but that may change. And then also with these pilot projects, how do you account for uncertainty? Have you found all of the zebra mussels? You'll never be able to answer that question, but what can you do to, I guess, buffer that uncertainty? So I just wanted to point this out. If you're curious about some of these projects that have taken place in Minnesota, just go to the Minnesota Department of Natural Resources website. Under the search tab, type in zebra mussel pilot projects, and you'll be directed to this list and some more information as well. These are some of the projects that have happened in Minnesota. Again, these are not whole lake projects. They are isolated zebra mussel populations, and most of our experience in terms of molluscicide treatments has been using a copper-based pesticide. So some of these case studies briefly that I'll go over will be Ruth Lake, which is in northern Minnesota, and then three lakes around the metro area, Christmas Lake, Lake Independence, and Lake Minnewashta. So Christmas Lake was, I would say, the first project where we learned a lot, where we, you know, I guess got to try all of these processes out. And through that process, you know, I would say that we didn't always make the right decision, but we learned throughout, you know, everything that we were doing. And it was also an effort that was very participatory, in the sense that the Lake Association was very actively involved. The area watershed district was very actively involved. Municipalities were very actively involved. And it really was a collaborative venture in terms of making decisions and doing our best effort to try to eradicate zebra mussels. The map, or the aerial photography on the right, shows a number of treatment polygons with different shadings. I guess the important note to take away from this is it began with the little square at the public access. Zebra mussels were discovered by the Minnehaha Creek Watershed District, which had a very robust early detection monitoring program. They had snorkeling surveys before the infestation and after the infestation, so they actually feel like fairly confidently they knew more or less when the infestation took place within a 2 to 3 week period, which is generally not the case for most of our infestations. The first treatment took place at the public access. The area was cordoned off. Stakeholder meeting took place, and Zequinox was a product that we used. It was effective. In all of these treatments, we've done caged mortality or bioassays in coordination with the treatment on site. So within the treatment area, we're monitoring for mortality basically daily and recording that information as well. So the first area of treatment, Equinox, was successful. Upon subsequent diving, we found more zebra mussels outside the treatment area. That area was then cordoned off and that's shaded with dots, and treated with first EarthTech QZ, copper-based pesticide, and then ice formed on. It was in the fall, ice formed, and we had some other requests already underway, in that we were looking to treat with potassium chloride or potash as well. So that was eventually approved by the EPA through an emergency exemption, and we tried treating under the ice. Ran into a number of difficulties, mainly due, I think, largely to temperature and the density of the product, inadequate mixing. But we learned from it. In the spring, zebra mussels were found at the hashed or checked area, and they were found actually hitchhiking on native mussels, which is in the photo there. And that area was cordoned off and treated with potash June of 2015, and then the Minnehaha Creek Watershed District and other partners requested a much larger buffered area of approximately 10 acres, and that was treated in July. And in hindsight, that much larger treatment area is likely what should have happened first. Next was Lake Independence. Lake Independence occurred basically concurrently at the same time of Christmas Lake. Three Rivers Park District has a very large, it's a multi-county park system within the metro, and they maintain a really large park on the southeastern shore of the lake. Zebra mussels were found at the public access, and they did appear to be isolated after we dove. It was decided we would basically do the same thing. Treatment first began with copper around the public access, and then we utilized potash after the emergency exemption was approved by the EPA. It was also treated in the following spring. Upon subsequent diving, zebra mussels were found beyond the treated area. And I'll kind of review all of the final results multiple years after at the end of the presentation. Next treatment was Ruth Lake up in northern Minnesota, found by the public, actually. The initial zebra mussels found by the public at a vacation rental home, reported to DNR. Subsequent dive efforts and survey efforts showed that it was an isolated population, and the aerial photo on the right shows an area of roughly 3 acres that was treated. Treatment began October of 2015, treated roughly over a 1 week period, maybe a little bit longer. Concentrations of EarthTech were maintained at one part per million copper, just some other specifics. Water temperature was right around 55 degrees Fahrenheit. Mortality again was assessed using cages. Once all the zebra mussels in the cages were dead, treatment was considered done. Subsequent survey efforts in 2016, a live zebra mussel was reported outside of this treatment area, maybe 1,000 feet or so away. And 2017, no zebra mussels were reported and no villagers have been seen to date. Last case study is Lake Minnewashta, also in the metro. Again, these are all occurrences, or this is another occurrence at the public access. Zebra mussels were introduced at the public access. The interesting thing about Lake Minnewashta is, due to the just shape of the lake itself, the lake basin is the aerial photo on the left shows an orange treatment area. There's naturally this kind of isolated, shallow bay, for the most part shallow bay, that presented itself well to natural containment of zebra mussels in terms of their spread. And so pre-treatment surveys were undertaken. Obviously, many areas throughout the rest of the water body were dove and examined, making sure that there was no evidence of zebra mussel anywhere else. Villager toes taken, no villagers. And this treatment took place August of 2016. It was roughly 30 acres. Largest, eradication effort had been undertaken in Minnesota. Same processes where mortality was measured with live zebra mussels in the treatment area. The photo on the lower right shows one method of that, using bioassays within an acrylic tube placed within a cage in the treatment area. Treatment was maintained again for roughly 10 days. With these copper treatments, they require multiple bumps within these contained areas to maintain adequate concentration. So I think there was roughly, within those 10 days, 5 different treatment events, or one main treatment and 4 bumps, you could say. So talking real briefly about overall evaluation of the projects, the important, just in a matter of time, we'll look at the final outcome at the last row on the bottom. I've kind of got a neutral face, could be a sad face, could be a zebra mussel. But basically, after Christmas Lake and Independence, zebra mussels were found outside the treatment areas. The neutral face, I would say, we used because we learned a great deal from these projects, and they've shaped our future efforts as well. You can see the cost there varied quite widely, depending on treatment size, but also products used. The Christmas Lake cost, 3 different pest molluscicides were used, and so the associated high cost of that. And then the treatment area sizes ranging from roughly an acre in size to around 29 acres in size. So real briefly, talking about success. Success, is potentially in the eye of the beholder here. Success in that we learned a great deal about these products. There was very, very little information available in the literature and very few case studies of inland treatments that had taken place. So in that mindset, we found that all these products can be 100% effective if concentrations are maintained. They're not all the same. There's different positives and negatives with each of the molluscicides that I've mentioned. Generally, though, the difficulty is not so much in killing them, it's in finding them. and containing zebra mussels early. And then obviously there's the threat of reinfestation after eradication efforts. So before one even undertakes these expensive projects, you know, what is the possibility that there will be another introduction shortly thereafter, and how will you know, resource managers account for those risks? And then quickly, some lessons learned. You know, if these aren't found early enough, you really can't do anything. So if there's not an early detection monitoring program, I think generally the likelihood of any sort of successful eradication effort is quite low. eDNA may be a really useful tool in this process in the future, but I don't have experience with it. Extensive in-lake surveys. So as you're trying to create a treatment area size, assess where the population is, dive, and then dive some more. And maybe then you'll have an idea that you know where the population may be localized. And then treatment size was a lesson that we learned through Christmas Lake specifically. The idea of buffering a treatment area sufficiently in size beyond where you think the limits of the infestation may be. And then there's some other best practices, using a curtain barrier within smaller treatment areas to maintain pesticide concentrations, monitoring the concentrations, obviously, is a requirement, and then looking at mortality through cage trials or bioassays. And then all of these projects, again, you know, couldn't have happened without partnerships with all the groups that I've mentioned, and communicating goals and actions with those groups. That's it.
Thanks, Keegan. We did have one question come in for you while you're talking, and you sort of were addressing it there at the end, but I'll ask it and just say, see if you want to add anything else. The question was the Christmas Lake 2015 potash treatment considered a successful eradication?
You know, it wouldn't be successful. It's not a successful eradication in that zebra mussels are still in the lake. It was successful that wherever we treated, the zebra mussels died. But zebra mussels were then found outside at the end of that summer at the other side of the lake. So successful eradication, no, because the zebra mussels persisted.
Thanks. And we got one more question, which I'll ask now, and then we'll move on to our next presenter and hold the rest of the questions to the end. But one more question for you right now, Keegan. Is the curtain barrier for containing zebra mussels or the pesticide?
Largely the pesticide. I mean, the idea of containing the zebra mussels makes perfect sense in terms of, you know, prevention of spread. But maintaining lethal pesticide concentrations is really what has to be the main consideration.
Great. Thank you again. We're going to move on to our next presenter, but keep submitting those questions, and we'll get back to the question answer session after this next presentation. Our next presenter is Thomas Wolf. Thomas Wolf worked for 10 years at the Idaho State Department of Agriculture, developing and implementing the state's Aquatic Invasive Species Program. And in 2017, he started as the Aquatic Invasive Species Bureau Chief for the state of Montana, and currently manages Montana's AIS program. So Tom, we should be getting your slides up right now. And if you can unmute yourself if you haven't already using star 6, we should be ready to go.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
And it seems like it advances. So thank you. My name is Tom Wolf, Montana Fish, Wildlife, and Parks. I am going to give a brief overview on what occurred in Montana here over the last year with the detection of mussels in the state for the first time. So in late 2016, Bureau of Reclamation contacted Montana Fish, Wildlife, and Parks regarding a detection of mussels in Tiber Reservoir. Tiber is a reservoir that's in north central Montana, near the High Line, close to the Canadian border. A very remote place, not a place one would think we'd have a potential first infestation mussels in the state, but that's where the report came from. Follow-up analyses of samples that were currently in the were in the Montana lab, lab processing the slowdown last season. So those samples are on the shelf. After that detection, they were pulled off and analyzed, and multiple villagers were observed in those samples from Tiber. So those two separate incidents with detection led us to label Tiber Reservoir as positive for mussels. Follow-up microscopy analysis of samples also indicated a villager in Canyon Ferry Reservoir next to the city of Helena. So Canyon Ferry is currently listed as a suspect water body following that detection. And those are the locations on the map on where Tiber is the northern dot in Montana and Canyon Ferry is the southern dot in the state of Montana. In response to those detections, the governor of Montana, Governor Bullock, declared a natural resource emergency that released funding and rulemaking authority immediately to respond to this mussel detection as an emergency. An incident command team was set up to support containment response and to elevate Montana's AIS program. It was able to put in place the framework to improve containment, improve outreach, and expand sampling and monitoring for early detection.
Hi, also, Tom, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but it looks like we may not be seeing your slides advance.
Hold on.
Hey, Tom, there should be a button at the top of your screen. There you go.
Thank you. So let me back up just so.
Sorry about that.
My apologies. So first slide, words. There's our map. The upper button is the Tiber infestation. The lower, the upper dot is Tiber. The lower dot is Canyon Ferry. So natural resource emergency declared. Tiber Reservoir was closed for a period of time, as well as boat ramps on Canyon Ferry. Those closures were lifted when containment was put into effect and mandatory watercraft inspection was stood up. So emergency rules were put in place, creating a mandatory inspection and decontamination for watercraft leaving Tiber and Canyon Ferry reservoirs. Also, mandatory inspection requirements were put in place for watercraft that are entering the state and also crossing the Continental Divide in the Columbia River Basin. So all watercraft crossing the divide also are required by statute to have an inspection. Funding mechanisms were also identified. The Montana legislature just happened to be meeting at that time and were able to allocate $13 million over 2 years with a combination of federal funds, a hydropower fee, and a fee associated with fishing license sales. 35 watercraft inspection stations were stood up. It was an increase of 22 stations from the previous season. Over 200 seasonal staff were hired to man those stations. Stations had extended hours, so many of them were in operation from dawn till dusk this past season. And also, Fish, Wildlife, and Parks supported partner stations through tribes, through local municipalities, through counties that wanted to increase inspection and prevention efforts locally in their respective areas. So this is a map of stations in 2017. Again, the intent was to set up stations on the perimeter of the state to inspect watercraft coming into the state, also crossing the Continental Divide, as well as containment inspection stations on Tiber and Canyon Ferry reservoirs. In addition, increased enforcement was put into the field last year with Fish, Wildlife, and Parks wardens assisting with compliance at watercraft inspection stations on the highways and also at our stations at Tiber and Canyon Ferry. Expanded survey also was put in place last year Sampling was almost tripled last season with increased plankton tow sampling for microscopy analysis, but also diving snorkeling surveys and shoreline surveys following drawdown. An education program was also expanded to convey the new rules and regulations to the public and also to reinforce the clean, drain, dry message so that the public could assist with that effort. And also expanding partnerships with local entities to get them involved with the education survey and watercraft inspection efforts statewide. From this last season, over 87,000 watercraft were inspected. Extensive surveys this season found no zebra or quagga mussel adults or veligers in the state. 1,500 plankton tow samples were collected. Substrate sampling samplers were deployed throughout the state. On Tiber and Canyon Prairie specifically, we brought in mussel sniffing dogs from Alberta to assist us in the drawdown zone to see if we could identify adult mussels. And again, none were found. We did have a research project this last season in partnership with USGS investigating parallel analysis with plankton tow survey sampling for microscopy analysis and environmental DNA. Several of those environmental DNA samples came back positive. However, we could not replicate them. So parallel samples that were collected did not come back positive. So in response to that, we're bringing together a scientific advisory panel to assist us. Environmental DNA for early detection has been a challenge throughout the West and how we approach it and how we utilize it, what it means. So we're going to bring in the scientific advisory panel this spring to help provide some guidance on how we use this type of information and how we communicate it. So that'll be something, a white paper will be generated and will be available to provide some background and some guidance on how we deal with this in the future. Lessons learned from the last season, quick response was key. The ability for the governor to declare an emergency freed up funds so that things could get moving quickly. It elevated the issue with decision makers and got their attention. Montana has extensive environmental ethic. The water is an extremely valuable resource here in the state, and the legislature and the public stepped up and allowed us to set up a program that would help accommodate protecting that resource. The detection in Montana also elevated the issue throughout the West and got people's attention that this could be a reality. We have mussels are moving and they're getting closer into the Northwest, and many states ramped up their programs in response, as well as Montana. Involving partners was important, and that will be expanded this next season to get more participation from partners around the state to assist with our efforts, and also expanding education and engagement with the public to help deliver that message so that boaters can do their part to clean, drain, and dry their watercraft to help in this prevention effort. For this next season, again, expanded partner involvement. We're evaluating the program to better address our risk out there too, targeting watercraft that are coming from places that we know are producing watercraft with adult mussels. We are transitioning to use the Colorado Watercraft Inspection app this next season so we can utilize electronic data entry to query previous inspections and better track risk for watercraft movement. And expanding survey next season to collect more samples, target survey in places where we would anticipate to find mussels to assist with early detection next season. Thank you. That's all I have.
Thank you, Tom. As a reminder, you can enter questions into the chat box, and it looks like we just had one come in. And it looks like this would be for you, Tom. Is clean, drain, dry, or clean, drain, dispose, and dry enforced? Based on 87,500 watercraft inspections, what was the violation rate or number of citations?
So last
season. And
there's
another follow-up to that as well, but we'll start there.
Okay. Last season, 80 citations were issued and nearly 300 warnings. According to Montana statute, it's illegal to transport standing water. However, the dry component of the of our clean, drain, dry isn't in statute. And most of our violations or our citations that were issued last season and warnings were issued due to failure to stop at watercraft inspection stations. The majority of stations in Montana are roadside, so it can be easy for somebody to drive by. And wardens were assisting with delivering that message that you do have to stop. It is the law.
And then the follow-up to that was based on that outreach. Was there any assessment to determine if awareness and behaviors have changed?
Yes, we should know that this next season. So the baseline data for awareness was collected last year. We do have an active program planned to assess how good we did this last season. So we should have some results here in the next 3 or 4 months, I think.
Great, thank you. So I want to open it back up to questions for all of the presenters at this point. So Allison and Keegan, if you are on mute, you can unmute yourselves again using *6. And Allison, we did have a couple of questions come in for you after your presentation, so I'm going to go back to those right now. Have you rejoined us on the audio?
Yes, I have.
Great. So the first question we had for you is how does Nebraska define suspect?
So in Nebraska, we consider suspect a single sampling event where you find a veliger, which is a larva, and no subsequent positive is found. So to be a positive water body, you have had two separate sampling events that have found zebra mussel larva. A suspect, you've only found one water sample to be positive.
And then the next question for you, Allison, still is what types of monitoring were used to determine if the treatments in 2009 were successful?
They employed.
Allison, I think you're breaking up a little bit. All right, well, we try to resolve Allison's audio issues. I have another question that came in for Keegan, if you're back with us, Keegan.
Yep.
Are the monitoring protocols for Minnesota available?
Definitely, yeah. My email address is at the end of the presentation. If not, you could put me in contact with anyone that needs it, yeah.
If they're publicly available, Keegan, often when we post the webinar recording, we'll post relevant documents with the webinar summary. So if that's something that you're willing to make available on the Mussel Collaborative website, we can also post it there with the webinar information.
Okay.
Allison, are you back with us?
Yes.
Okay, we can hear you again. You were cut off about partway through your answer to the monitoring for treatments in 2009.
Okay, so we placed sampling plates throughout the water body to look for zebra mussels to grow on them, and we did not find any. And then they also did veliger toes to look for larvae.
And another question for you, Allison. What did the power company do with the outwash and the piles of the 6 million zebra mussels and shells after the power washing?
I can't tell you about the 6 million shells because I haven't heard back yet. But I can tell you that when they were flushing the system, it was going back into the Missouri River, and they were using high pressure wash to wash them off.
Thank you. And one more question, Allison, for you. the Lake Zarinsky drawdown and freeze, how did that or did it impact fish populations?
It did. They had many large catfish and carp died. There was the ability for the fish to move upstream to a creek, and so likely that was able to save fish, but there definitely were fish kills. Yep.
Thank you. We had another question come in, and this is a general question, a question about which states are still infestation free. If anybody, if the speakers want to comment on that, you're welcome, but I would direct people to the USGS Non-Indigenous Aquatic Species Database, and they have a map of all of and records of zebra and quagga mussel findings, and you can look at the status of those populations, whether they were considered established, eradicated, et cetera. So that would be my first recommendation if you're interested to see where zebra and quagga mussels currently are to access the USGS NAF database map. But Tom, Allison, or Keegan, if you want to add anything in response to that question, please do so.
I would mention that my website, anyinvasives.com, does have a link to that page you mentioned.
Yeah, and I'll just mention the northwestern states currently don't have them, so there's a definitely a big push to try to keep them out of the Columbia River Basin and the northwest U.S.
And so we have another question for Keegan. You mentioned mussels hitchhiking on uniotted clams. Was that the primary way you think that juveniles and adults moved from Christmas, far from the Christmas Lake boat ramp?
It would just be, I would be speculating if I said, I mean, we did find a number of mussels that were hitchhiking on the unionids. They do, for whatever reason, seem to at times prefer that as a settlement substrate. It also depends on what's there. The substrate in Christmas Lake in this particular area was for lack of better terms, basically mucky and, you know, vegetation filled and not a lot of rocky substrate. But that being said, the zebra mussels that were found post-treatment on other sides of the lake had to have drifted there. Either, I'm assuming, at a as villagers or potentially have been spawned within the lake and drifted there post-spawning.
Thanks, Keegan. Another question for you on the copper treatment. Could it be effective in a large flow-through system?
Yes. It can be effective in large flow-through systems as long as concentrations are maintained over in a required period. So one specific example, I've worked with St. Paul Regional Watershed, which provides water to the majority of residents in St. Paul. They pull water from the Mississippi River and then through a series of lakes. Some of those lakes are infested with zebra mussels, so at their intake sites to the water treatment plant, they do low-dose treatments of copper to try to maintain those areas free. So this is, 5-foot conduits, hundreds of feet long, that they're maintaining free in a flowing system. But it's through kind of a low-dose, we'll call it just like a drip exposure, which I think is maybe, somewhat common in industry applications. The use of potential molluscicides in riverine systems. DNR has done one project, which was quite a few years back, and I think it is possible theoretically to maintain those systems free through these kind of low dose exposures. But it's complicated as well.
Thanks, Keegan. And then you actually wrote in a question for Tom.
Yeah.
Asking about preliminary results comparing plankton toes to eDNA, or is there anything more that you can say about that comparison?
Yeah, you bet. So the comparison of methods was collecting a plankton toe for the purpose of microscopy analysis, side by side with a gallon of water collected at the surface that's filtered and then sent off for DNA analysis. And in that case, the gallon of water came back as positive on several samples. The plankton toe analysis came back negative for veligers through microscopy. That split sample, the microscopy sample, was sent off to a lab for DNA analysis, and that came back clearly negative. So working on seeing if we can get some more standardized results, identify what the better methods are for the environmental DNA methods for Mussel early detection specifically.
Thanks. And then back to Allison, if you're still with us, we had a couple more questions come in for you. One is, somebody asked, if I remember correctly, in Nebraska, they were working to cover the riprap, and what's being used to cover it, and is it to suffocate the mussels?
Dan James, who is with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service in South Dakota, is the environmental consultant for the base lake, and he's looking into ways to cover the riprap in concrete so that zebra mussels can't attach to it, and also covering them and suffocating them. But it's more of how to get that concrete covered so that they can't attach to it is kind of his idea, at least. The base monetarily can't take out the riprap, which would be probably the best solution. So he's looking at the secondary idea to somehow cover it.
And then another question for you regarding the proposal to introduce red-eared sunfish. The question is there a danger related to creating an imbalance in fish populations by doing that?
It hasn't been an issue. They're fun to catch, and a lot of people do angle at the lake, and so they haven't had any concern in terms of the fisheries diversity, and they do study that on an annual basis.
Thanks. I'm not seeing any more questions come in on the Skype. So at this point, I will just ask each of our presenters if you have anything else that you wanted to add for the good of today's webinar related to your presentation or any other questions that you had. So Keegan, Tom, or Allison, is there anything else you wanted to say or ask before we wrap up today?
No. No, thanks.
So then I think we can adjourn early for today. Thank you to all of our speakers for today's webinar. As we wrap up, I did want to mention our next webinar, which an announcement will be going out for as soon as we're done this afternoon. And that webinar is related to the influences of physical water properties on mussel treatment, and we'll have several presentations on recent research, so would encourage you to sign up for that webinar. As I said, the announcement and registration will be going out shortly after we end this one this afternoon. But thank you again to Allison, Keegan, and Tom, and thanks to everybody for participating and your patience with some of our technology issues today. And also thanks to my colleagues here in the room with me, Cecilia Weibert and Eric Ellis, who do a lot of the behind-the-scenes planning work to pull these webinars together. So thank you all, and we look forward to talking with you on our next webinar. Have a great weekend.